Hello and good evening to one and all. Welcome back. My name is Surendra Bora. I am an entrepreneur by profession. And I'm continuing with the series where we are interviewing with a talk series called Entrepreneurs Dialogue, where we catch up with entrepreneurs, with CEOs, with associate directors of various top organizations and various top brands. We are all a part of, first of all, I would like to thank all our viewers who have been part of, who have seen our earlier videos of Entrepreneur Series, the talk series, and their feedbacks, their comments, and I'm really thankful for all those comments and positive feedbacks which have been given, and really thrilled to come back with another video. So we are here back now. And our guest for today, we are in the lockdown. Chennai is actually in complete lockdown. And today is a very, very special day. It's an International Yoga Day, solar eclipse, and Father's Day. So in midst of all this, I thought if we can call some an amazing entrepreneur who can enlighten us with his journey, his success journey of what he has achieved, and definitely can make a lot of difference. So once again, I welcome you all to this talk series called Entrepreneurs Dialogues. So please keep watching. Do you all want to know the success mantra for building a successful chain outlet? So our guest for today is truly a visionary. When I say a visionary, when I'm going to give you the introduction of the guest, you will definitely know what I'm going to say. Truly a visionary, because he's been helping hundreds and thousands of people change their visions on a daily basis. Yes, it's my honor and privilege, my dear friend, a very, very simple, very, very aggressive, very focused and dedicated, who has grown from Spec Makers is the name of the brand, and his name is Prateek Shah. He's the CEO. So I would like you all to introduce Mr. Prateek Shah among us. Hi, Prateek.
Hi, Surendra. Thank you, and appreciate the opportunity given. And thank you for bringing me on the show. It's a privilege to be a part of your questionnaire and, you know, your dialogue. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much for accepting. I'm sure this was a lockdown, so I caught you here. Otherwise, it's difficult to catch you.
No. That's absolutely my pleasure. My pleasure. Yeah.
So, before we move on to the questions, I would like to formally introduce our guest today. His name is Prateek Shah. Company name, he's the CEO of Spec Makers Opticians Private Limited, and is India's fastest growing chain. They are currently having 295 plus stores running, and they're expanding their reach continuously in new geographies. That's fantastic. And currently they are having their presence in 35 plus cities in the south alone, and they are continuously expanding throughout the country very fast, very rapidly. Pan India operations, they want to go. Spec Makers work on a complete company owner, company operated module, and has its store and on an average size of 350 square feet. We are proud, they are proud actually, they are proud to create a niche for themselves in the eyewear of the industry. So they, not only that, Spec Makers actually manufactures its own brand of frames and optical lenses, and it's 100% single brand retailer, which is their USP. And they believe in providing professional eye care services at affordable prices and exceptional customer service. And not only that, if not for the lockdown, or probably still way ahead, in 2020, Spec Makers' vision is to spread over 500 plus stores. Currently, they are in 295 stores. And today, he is going to share us his success journey, and he is going to share us the success mantra of such an building this kind of retail chain outlet. So Prateek Bhai, once again, welcome to you to this talk series.
Thank you Surendra.
I'm going to ask you some few questions, and so definitely you'd like to enlighten on that. Yes, our sure. First question is something which is relevant to the current situation, which is like, what does it take for a chain outlet like yours, the Spec Makers, which is having 295 plus stores operating, to survive in this kind of pandemic situation right now? We are all going through, but how does it take for you? Can you just share?
So I think obviously nobody knows to survive a pandemic. You know, that's the bottom line of a pandemic. If you know to survive it, then it's not a pandemic for you. You know, so I think the biggest challenge for a chain store like us to survive the pandemic was to first understand what will happen to our employees. Okay, we are a very employee focused company, about 1200 employees working in the company. So the day, so we were kind of not really aware that something like this will strike us, because we have great relations with the international suppliers, and you know, we converse and we trade a lot with China also. But when it struck in China in January, we understood what China was doing, because Jan, Feb, March is when they were completely, you know, going through a lockdown, and when our suppliers were telling us that, you know, it's going to be very horrible. And when it went to Italy, we kind of started looking at saying that, okay, what if it comes into India? So we were kind of saying that even if there is a 10% chance for it to come to India, let's prepare for the worst. So when it struck on, so I was in China in December. I came back on December 23rd from China. And when it struck in China in Jan, I think what we decided to do is first go back to the drawing board and see if COVID strikes, what happens to India? What happens to us? Right? We never thought that a pandemic will strike India. But I think when it struck, we started seeing the effect from the last week of February, when we started seeing that, you know, the first case came in India, in Kerala, then the way it spread. So I basically had an idea whether this is going to really be large, but I never expected at this scale. We were very clear as to what we have to prepare ourselves for. So first we did is roll back our sleeves and said, okay, for this financial year, Jan to March, there'll be no expansion. And March, the next two quarters of the next financial year, we will wait and watch. So we started just holding on to ourselves. But when actually the Honorable Prime Minister announced the lockdown on March 22nd and 24th, which went into a 15-day lockdown, it was a difficult situation for us, because your cash flows completely come to a standstill. Your business is zero, your expenses are 100%, right? And since we keep hiring people month on month in view of wanting to expand more stores, we had hired about 90 people odd in the month of Feb and March, because we were going to expand. But I think what we took a decision is we will hold on to all our people. We will not retrench them. We went back to the drawing board, decided what is the cost angle that we can cut, where we can cut corners, where we can basically trim costs. And I think we laid out a 12-month plan. And the 12-month plan that we laid out is basically saying that if the pandemic is only till April 14th, and then how long will business take to come back to normal? Will it be by May, by June or July? So we created three business scenarios. One is lockdown till April end, lockdown till May end, lockdown till June end. I never prepared for a lockdown till July end. So that's another business model that I'm making at the moment. But decided to go back, see your stores, which are non-profitable, start talking to the landlords. You know, every January, we take a decision on 10% of our stores to be churned and shut down. Okay, so by this, when we were 295 stores in Jan, we had issued a notice to about 25 stores that in March, we will relocate the stores or we will shut them down. Because, you know, you can't have all the stores doing good. There will always be a 10% at the bottom. And you have to look at business as business, no emotions. So these 10% of the stores are anyway going to go in March, right? We became a little bit aggressive. We increased the count from 10% to 14%. And we said that, okay, we will not operate 295. We will operate 260 stores. And fortunately, some landlords came back to us and said, you know, please continue with the stores. We will wait until your business comes back to normal for your rentals to be kind of paid out. So we are still at 270 stores at the moment right now. And I think that was one angle at the store level. Second is the company, we got onto a Zoom call with all our employees, did a town hall meeting of all our 1,000 employees plus, made them understand. First, you have to give confidence to the employees. They should start feeling that, okay, will the company survive or no? And as a CEO, that's your job to basically make them feel comfortable. So I think what we did is we made them realize that, you know, we are here to stay. We have created a great brand. We have created a great business. So nothing to worry. So we paid out the March salaries, April salaries, May salaries. Everything is paid out. So we survived the pandemic. And it is the support of the employees also that really played a pivotal role. The employees all came together as a family. And this is the time when you realize that the employee is not an employee, he's a partner in your company. And that culture which I built from day one has really played out today. Because we never treat our employees as employees. We treat them as a part of the business. So I think everybody, I would not even say that even 10% of my employees felt really bad for the certain decisions that we took. We were absolutely fine. So that's how we survived the entire pandemic. You know. But yeah, as a company, obviously rollout plans will be shelved right now. Expansion plans will be put on hold until we start seeing the new normal. Until businesses don't come back to 85-90% of the pre-COVID, we don't think it makes wise sense to even look at new opportunities at the moment. You have to look at business within your business rather than looking at new businesses.
That was really nice sharing, to look at the business as business and not to bring the emotional side. And not only
never,
that.
Never bring emotions in between. Let it be for employees or let it be for the showrooms.
True. And starting out and sharing what you are going through right now is on hand live. What you have been planning, charting out for 12 months is something very, very amazing. And that's what I think truly a success lies in. Your success lies in. I think SpecMakers have been doing a phenomenal job, and handling the employees is again not a joke. And I think 1,200 employees to satisfy them is fantastic. Super.
Yeah.
Again, continuing the next question is, what do you call? You have 295 stores, you said, Pratik.
Yeah.
What is your journey from zero to 295? How did it start, and was it planned? And does it go to handle these kind of? What was your journey? Can you just share in brief? So
yeah, I think the journey was very very erratic. I would say it was not planned. There's no way I was going to come in this business. It was fortunately unfortunate, unfortunately fortunate. I was in the US, came back, was wanting to work for an investment bank, decided that I will go the investment banking route. I wanted to be a trader or a stockbroker or be a part of some investment bank where, you know, you get to be on the finance side. And that's what I studied, and marketing and finance was my forte. But I think my family hails from the optical business, and, you know, and being the only son, was looking at an opportunity whether I can look at this business as an opportunity. My dad started off the first store in 2005 under the name Venkateshwara Optics. But as a part of learning the business, I went and changed the name from Venkateshwara Optics to SpecMakers, because I wanted to create a brand that is appealing to everybody and not to any particular genre of people, you know? And I think if you keep the name simple, the brand becomes more relevant and remembered, right?
Gotcha.
You can't have Venkateshwara Optics as a brand which is having a vision to go a pan India or a global brand, right? Because a Venkateshwara Optics can be copied by anybody. It can be Venkateshwara Traders, Venkateshwara Music, and everything. So SpecMakers is a name that I came out with, which was very simple. What am I making? I'm making specs. That's it. So
wonderful.
Came out with that name, decided to open the first store in 2007. 2008, I opened my second store. 2009, we opened two more stores. Became five stores. 2010, we opened two stores. So I think what we did is, before you start building a 1,000-story building, as an architect, you have to, and a civil engineer, you have to decide that how deep your foundation has to be. You can't first build a weaker foundation for 10 floors and then on that build 1,000-floor building. The building will fall. I think, the entire opportunity that I looked at that point in time was, how deep should I get into my foundation, you know, and decided to bring in the systems, the policies in place, and see whether, you know, we build the foundation completely for looking at a 100-store company. So we spent a lot of time on that. We looked at completely going ahead and, building the foundation in the first 4-5 years. My wife joined me in 2009 once we got married, and she's a CEO in the company. So building a foundation, building a strong system, process, and then build on that, you can build even 500,000 stores, because you don't have to really tweak the process completely. So I think that was one of the key elements. One of the key criteria that I looked at is you don't have to spread your legs too wide to basically create a larger customer base. You can go deep also. So I studied the business model of DMart, Sir Radhakrishna Damani, and saw what, you know, that end of the day, you want to sell glasses. You sell it in Chandigarh or you sell it in Chennai. You want to do volumes. It doesn't matter. There's no first more advantage of entering a particular city. Aap 5 saal ke baad bhi ja sakte ho. So I think if Chennai's got 3,000 optical stores, why can't you have 100? Why can't you have 300? 10% of the market share. You build a profitable business by going deeper into the geographies that you operate, and then replicate that business in different geographies where you want to go. Rather, if you have about 300 stores in 300 cities, operationally it becomes a very big challenge. Your overheads go up very high. Then your cost of marketing in pan India is very expensive. Then your cost of operations is very expensive. Cost of logistics is very expensive. So end of the day, I think your economies of scale will only come when you have a larger volume in a particular city. You know, so I think that was the key criteria with which we decided to penetrate deeper, go deep rather than go wide. And that was the key. And we never understood what is the saturation point. So is 50 stores a saturation, 100 stores a saturation, 300 a saturation? As long as you run it as a profitable business and every store is profitable of yours, you keep adding stores. You know, yeah, you in my business, obviously, there is cannibalization. One AK location where when you open two stores, there is a split of business from your first to the second. But the overall business between the two is larger than the first one. And correct. If overall of the business is profitable, you're fine. So that's our journey completely. We just entered Hyderabad last year in September. We just about 10, 11 stores in Hyderabad. And we are in Bangalore about 75 stores, Chennai about 100 stores. I think the plan is now to basically scale up the south to about 350 stores and then look at the west, which is Maharashtra, and then Gujarat. You know, so we are looking at one state at a time. So that's the entire policy that you want to work with.
Truly an inspiring journey, Pratik bhai, because I know you personally. Back in 2014-15, I remember you were 10 to 15 stores, and now scaling up to 295 stores is like phenomenal growth. Really hats off and the commitment which is done. Pratik bhai, everything and everyone is going digital now. Are we going to see a new era in offline? And we know that everything is going online, because everyone is going online. A lot of mediums, a lot of businesses are shifting their focus. But what happens to offline? Is there some new era coming up, new operations coming up? What is your focus? Since you are trying to expand, and you are, in fact, your goal is to reach 500 stores in 2020. So, like, what is your strategy or what do you think?
I think digital is here to stay. Of course, it depends on the product that you're selling. Offline versus online retailing is now the trend is basically become you capture the customer online, but make him transact offline.
Oh, good.
So your entire digital marketing, your omni-channel, you have to be there online as a lookbook, as a understanding for the customer to know you better before he wants to enter your store offline. You know, unfortunately, our product cannot be really like a t-shirt or a shirt does not have a standardized sizing. So people, we have started our online e-commerce business and is doing very well. We've seen a 300% growth in the last quarter, and we sell pan India. But I think being an offline retailer, online is another vertical for us. It's like another store, you know. But yes, for everybody who's there in the offline business, you need to have a website and you need to showcase your catalog. It is very, very important for the customer to see what reviews you're getting, what's the kind of rating of your website, how far, what are the kind of products you sell. The customer wants to be well prepared to come to your store before he comes to your store.
True.
It is not like earlier, it was very different. You know, after he comes to the store, you basically, the customer will tell, okay, mereko kuch dikhao. But now the customer comes with a product in his mobile and says, ye product maine website pe dekha tha, can I buy it? So it reduces your transaction time, gives you stickiness to the customer, makes the customer see your product, makes the customer talk about your product to other people. You know, makes the decision making capacity of the customer very easy, because at home he can decide with his wife, do you like this product? I'm going to go buy this. You know, like even in your lighting business, before they decide what chandelier they want to buy, maybe both don't have to travel. They can look at the product and decide it online and come to the store and just look at it physically and make a payment and transact it. So I think, online is the new mantra. Omni-channel is the new mantra. And you have to acquire customers online to transact offline.
Very nice. I really thank all the people who are watching right now, and they will watch later. I'm sure a lot of points which you have shared will add a lot of value. As an entrepreneur, we all know what it takes to run a business and to run multiple chain of business successfully. That is something is there any success mantras which are there you would like to share, Pratik Bhai? Like, what is there for building a successful retail chain outlet, since you're into retailing? So I'm just sharing, putting
any,
it across
any,
chain outlets.
So, any success mantras? You need to fail once.
You need to fail once. Okay.
You need to go through that failure once for you to understand where you were wrong. There is no full-fledged recipe for a business. So as you keep running your business, you have to understand where your failures are and correct them. It's a course correction as you move forward, right? There is nobody. Let it be from the CEO of the biggest company like an Amazon till Steve Jobs till anybody. You need to fail on your path to success. You need to have small failures and accept it. Like, we in the starting picked up some wrong stores, we shut it.
Okay.
You are running a business for yourself, not for the society. Okay. You feel that the business is not giving you money, the society is not going to come and give you money for the business.
Yeah.
Okay. And sometimes a wrong decision in a store can ruin your good stores also. It might take away your mood. It might. So when we were at 3 stores, we had given the 4th store as a franchisee. Okay. We picked up a wrong location. We picked up a wrong franchisee partner. And unfortunately, we had to shut the store in 6 months. Okay. That taught us basically what it takes to select a right franchisee, select a right location. Sometimes you get greedy. Okay. That you want to open more number of stores. But I think the pace at which you want to open should be linked to the pace at which you want to grow. I mean, opening a store is no big thing. It takes 20 days. It requires capital. It requires a location. But is it the right location? Is it the right street? Is it the right catchment? Is it the right customer base? Is it the right area where you want to sell? You do your study. After you map a catchment, then you go about it. So sometimes people, in wanting to just grow, go and open wrong centers, wrong locations. You should have the guts to close it if it's not right. Okay. So I always tell my employees that don't look at yourself as a, saying that you are 100 stores and then you are 200. They are only milestones on your way. Okay. If this pandemic continues for a larger time, if the company does not see business in some good stores also, the company will shut down the good stores. Doesn't matter. End of the day, you have to run profitably. If you're selling something, you take money back home. Business is created to run business. And from business comes charity, not from charity comes business. You know, we are not in the business of charity. So I think you have to be very brutal. You have to be very clear on your numbers. I think on that aspect, I'm very, very honest and very brutal. If a store is not working, please shut it. There's no two ways about it. And people's emotions are attached. Employees' emotions are attached. The team's emotions are attached that we'll give it another 6 months or something. We give it 6 months to 9 months. If it doesn't turn around, we say, okay, it's fine. End of the day, what is going to happen? One store will be less. You relocate the store to another place. How does it matter?
Correct.
Right? And so if you have made a mistake in business, learn from it. If you feel that your ego comes in between your mistake, that's the failure, beginning of the failure.
Yeah. Very nice. Really nice, Pratik Bhai. One last question which I would like to ask you. See, as an entrepreneur, during this lockdown, everyone has been very low. So what is your one positive message to entrepreneurs? If you feel that as an entrepreneur, you want to share to all the entrepreneurs, like, what is one message which you think will be a positive and a takeaway for everyone?
This one will also pass by. Don't worry. Okay.
Oh,
Chennai
okay.
has been enough. We've seen the tsunami. We've seen the floods. We've seen the water. We've seen the pandemic. Don't worry. This one will also pass by. Just hold on to your seat. Don't give up. And keep your employees with you. Don't fire them. Just keep them with you. Give them the confidence that they'll stick around with you. You know, give them that the past 3 months you've crossed, March, April, May, June, July, just cross it. It's just, we are at 80% of the bridge. I think we are supportive of the fact what the Chief Minister has taken a decision for Chennai. It's okay to go through this 12 days and then have good 120 days rather than, you know, living in fear. And I think the new normal is to take care of your health, take care of your cleanliness, hygiene and everything. But I think the pandemic is also more of fear than the disease. This is one time I'm seeing where the fear is more fearful than the disease itself. So, you know, I keep telling my employees, it's just another flu. At least for our health and our reasons, we don't have to get worried. But yes, if you have some other health issues, then yes, you have to be a little bit more healthy and improve your immunity. But this one will pass by. There's nothing eternal. We've seen smallpox in 1918, measles, H1N1, Zika, so many flus. But this is not that fatal. And I think we are strong enough as entrepreneurs to see much more other pandemics in our world.
True. Right. Yeah. I think very, very important and a much needed information for everyone. And I really thank you, Pratik Bhai, for taking your time out. I'm really glad that you have accepted and come over to share your success journey and success mantras and what it takes to run a multiple chain outlet and that to a huge success. And I really wish and that you continue your journey and as your target is 1,000 stores. And you continue doing that, friends. www.specsmakers.in is a website, and I needn't have to say that you can go there, visit, and you will get at most affordable prices and with the best quality manufactured here. Thank you once again, everyone, for watching and here now and later also, and keep encouraging. Please share your feedbacks, comments in the comment box, and we shall come back to you with yet another video with an entrepreneur in the talk series called Entrepreneurs Dialogue. Thanking you so much for watching. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Surinder.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, Pratik.